You're listening to the 12th Man Fan Jam on the Seahawk Positivity YouTube channel. And now it's time for another edition of the 12th Man Fan Jam with your host, the Reverend Moses of the St. Paul Allen Church of Seahawk Positivity.
Yes, thank you, Magic Voice. This is the self-appointed Reverend Moses of the St. Paul Allen Church of Seahawk Positivity, and welcome one and all to a very special Panther edition of the 12th Man Fan Jam, the show made up of Seahawk fans from around the world talking about your Super Bowl champion, Seattle Seahawks. Over the next few moments we share together, we hope you are entertained, we hope you are enthralled, and we hope you are, of course, enlightened as we discuss the upcoming game for your Super Bowl defending champion, Seattle Seahawks, against the Carolina Panthers. So sit back, relax, grab a desired beverage or scent of your choice, and remember, black cats are bad luck. Why put them on your helmet? As is the usual with every show, we are not alone. No, I am joined like I am every episode by the 12th Man Fan Jam Posse, a ragtag group of diehard Seahawk fans from around the world. First, the yin to my yang. You can find his Minecraft videos on the Suffolk Blue YouTube channel. He's never too catty. From merry old England, he is Matt.
Good morning, Moses. How are you?
Wonderful, Matt. How are you today?
Well, I bring good news and bad.
You always do. What is the good news?
The good news is that we look like our tight end, Doug Wilson, is probable to play this week.
Yay! What's the bad news?
Everybody else is out.
Yeah. Boo. Kids didn't cheer for that, but
we'll cover that later.
We'll cover that later extensively, I'm sure. Next, from the state of Washington, our very own news hound. His 12th Man editorials can be found on the SeahawkSal.com website. He's a cat lover, but a Panther hater. You know him as Shadowhawk. We know him as Will. Hi, Will.
Hi, Moses. I thought I was coming from the state of denial.
Many of us are right now, I think. Many people in 12th Man Nation are in a little bit of denial, but hopefully we'll bring you back to the homeland here in Seahawk Positivity. And also from Washington are a microwave beer brewer. He has never seen the musical Cats. He is Dustin. Hi, Dustin.
Hey, guys. I just want to throw this out there real quick. It's good to see everybody again. But this is the newly sober Dustin. I stopped drinking a couple weeks ago.
Very nice.
I'm done with that.
Let's the kids dig that.
Yep. So
the kids dig that.
The drinking punchlines are out. Punchlines are out. High punchlines, still in play.
Dustin will not be on the show anymore. We have no report on it. Oh, ITs. Congratulations, Dustin. And we're pulling for you, buddy. And finally, last but not least, in the guest seat this evening, here for his triumphant return to the show, and I hope the audio works this time. His first book, Notes from a 12-Man, a truly biased history of the Seattle Seahawks, is a must-read for any Seahawk fan. And he has a new book, Seattle Seahawks Super Season, Notes from a 12 on the best season in Seahawks history, is flying off the bookshelves at a dizzying rate. Emmy Award-winning Seahawk fan and author, Mark Tye Turner. Yay! Hi, Mark.
Thank you, Moses. Thank you. It's great to be here. I love the big crowd noise there too.
The kids are here. The kids are awake. It's a little late, but they've been on fall break, so they can cheer. So it's all right. Mark, what have you been up to since we last talked together on the show?
Well, I have written a second book that's all about our super season. In fact, it's called Seattle Seahawks Super Season, Notes from a 12 on the Best Season in Seahawk History, which, of course, you mentioned before, so I'm just being redundant.
That's all
anyway,
right.
That came out a couple months ago, and I've been out promoting it.
Wonderful.
Shilling the book, and shucking it, too.
Chilling and shucking. Can you chill and shuck at the same time?
I believe it's in pot. Could be wrong, but but I was just up in the great Pacific Northwest just last week where I saw Mr. Moses.
Indeed you did.
At different Seahawk related events.
Yes, yes, we did. We broke bread over many different Seahawk events. It was a very exciting a week for my family, especially seeing a lot of old friends up there. And but that was a while ago, and unfortunately, we must press on, and the intros have been made. So let's get to the show. I know you're anxious to get started. For those of you who've listened before, we want to thank you for joining us again. For those who are listening for the first time, don't worry. We promise we'll be gentle, but be careful. Matt's desperate for a win, so you know what that means. The show is run like an NFL game. There are four quarters and even a two-minute warning. In the first quarter, we will catch up on all the NFL news that we may have missed. In the second quarter, we will go over last week's loss to the Rams briefly with good, bad, and ugly. Halftime will be a special play-along halftime trivia that you can play along with as well, and I have a surprise for the guys on that, a mild surprise. They're always fun. Yes, and Statsman Mark is not here this evening, and he is the defending champ, so the championship is literally up for grabs tonight, so get excited about that. In the third quarter, we'll talk to Medic Matt about all the injuries that are on the Seahawks team and Carolina and see how that affects the game this Sunday. And in the fourth quarter, we will do our predictions, our prognostications, and our game balls. So, also failed to mention that we will have a special headlines and punchlines at the two-minute warning at the second quarter, a special thing where we take a headline from the NFL world and we turn our own little punchline to it to try to get great laughs had by all. It's a very exciting time. And speaking of exciting time, let's get started with the news.
Who knows? The shadow knows.
Yes, only the Shadow knows the news, and that's our very own Shadow Hawk, Will. Hi, Will. What do you got for us this evening?
Well, Moses, Seahawks and Seahawk fans are not the only ones who are upset with the referees lately. Steelers wide receiver Antonio Brown made some headlines after the Steelers-Texans game. Brown at one point appeared to catch a touchdown, but was ruled on the field that he did not get both feet in bounds. Brown, surprisingly, did not agree with that call and posted a picture on his Twitter feed that supposedly showed both feet in bounds with the caption, effing refs. he took it down shortly thereafter and came back and said, apologies for cursing the refs, but dang. Well, and basically said later on the radio, it said, when you're passionate about something, you speak your mind. But you got to think this sort of thing is not going to help him the next time he gets a close call.
Well, don't you think the F meant fun-filling refs? Isn't that what he...
The other thing is that he could buy all the referees flowers and chocolates and they still would make the wrong calls. So you might as well just die F.
How would you really know, Matt? He hasn't tried it yet.
Oh!
What, me? I don't play football. Why would I buy the flowers and chocolates?
I think that meant something else. He said effing refs. Fascinating refs. They're fascinating.
They're just awful. Flipping useless is what I was in.
What are the commissioners thinking of all this? Or has he enacted any sort of penalty?
Is that the effing commissioner? Or just the commissioner?
The effing commissioner. I guess if you say effing commissioner, that maybe I could get you that.
But we're just saying he's fascinating, or he's fun-filling. Or
yeah, because everybody looks at Goodell and calls him fun-filled.
Look at him. He's a ball of laughs.
Just a barrel, barrel of monkeys, you know?
Yep.
The guy is fantastic.
One big joke.
He's MFing. He's mega fantastic-ing.
No effing commissioner.
No, effing commissioner.
Plus he makes like $50 million a year too.
So Dustin, do you think
really?
Yeah, it is. Dustin, do you think that you know, Antonio, he's on Twitter, he has a right to say that. Does he have a right to say that, or do you think there should be something done?
Dustin, I'm sorry, one more time. I was a little distracted. Say that one more time.
Do you think that maybe he should get in trouble for putting us on his Twitter, Antonio Brown, or do you think it's okay?
There's two different things there. Do I think he should get in trouble for that? No, I don't.
Okay.
I think they should be able to speak out about those type of things because there's obviously faults in what happens. Okay. Do I think he will get in trouble? I feel like the NFL will probably come down on him about that. Right. So I have kind of two different mind frames about that.
I agree.
That have to set an example.
That's pretty accurate.
Yeah. Matt? Well, they'll have to set an example. Look, the fact is, the referees are making so many bad calls because of so many new rules which have been introduced to try and make this game something which it probably shouldn't be, that they're going to make some really bad calls, certainly with the number of penalties rising the way they are. So, ultimately, if the NFL doesn't come down on players and say, look, you know, you don't get to referee the refs, so you don't get to do that on Twitter, fans can do it because they can't fine us, but they can fine the players, and that's exactly what will happen, I assume.
Hey, man, they're screwing with my fantasy football scores, all right? So just let them do what they got to do to fix it, all right? Come on. God.
This is all about fantasy football now.
That's what it is, man.
It's all effing fantasy now, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's what he meant. Well, see, that's what football playing.
Well, it's a good thing I don't get in trouble on Twitter for after Sunday's game, what I had to say about the basically wanted him fired.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I
there
agree.
Would be a lot of fans fined. It would be if the NFL could fine fans for arguing about the refs after Sunday's game, we would all be a lot poorer.
Sad but true.
Sad but true. Will, what else you got for us?
Well, Aaron Rodgers found out that he has a new boss.
Aaron Rodgers, the quarterback for the Packers?
Yes, he does. As you know, the Green Bay Packers are publicly held, and pretty much anybody with the available money can buy a share of stock in the team. It doesn't really make them owner, but it looks good hanging up on your wall. funny thing is, his new owner is a Bears fan. He recently went to a Pearl Jam concert and ran into Eddie Vedder. Who is a Bears fan. However, according to Rodgers, he said Vedder told him that a buddy had gotten him a stock certificate for the Packers a few years back. So, one of the owners of the Packers is a fairly famous Bears fan.
And that's Eddie Vedder.
Yep.
Rodgers was sure to
point out that he didn't geek out in the situation. He didn't need a pep talk. He didn't get nervous. He just talked to Eddie Vedder and had a good conversation.
That's pretty funny. Mark, you had something to say about Vedder?
Well, I was going to say, Eddie is originally actually from the Chicago area, I believe.
Ah.
There you go. He's the one member of Pearl Jam that's not from the Seattle area.
Ah, so that's wonder well, why they never him. Really... Why, yeah, I wonder why they never really said much, you know, like... You know, Soundgarden came out, and of course, Macklemore is known. And I thought, where's Pearl Jam? You know, you think Eddie Vedder would be like, go Hawks, but apparently that's a bad thing for him.
Yeah, well, the other guys in the band have actually raised the flag. Mike McCready and also Stone Gossard. Yeah, those two guys raised the flag once. I was actually at the game, and I think it was the game against the Bears back in, I think it was like 2007.
That's irony.
Nice choice.
Which is kind of funny. I think they kind of did it to probably poke fun at Eddie on that one.
Oh, but I bet they did. Yeah, I mean, they did.
And the band, Pearl Jam, is, you know, the original name for Pearl Jam was Mookie Blaylock, who played for the Bulls. Yep. But Mookie was not a big fan of having a band named after them.
Right.
So changed it to Pearl Jam.
And that's why their first major album was 10, because that's Mookie's number.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yep. So.
You listen a lot of Pearl Jam over there, Matt. Is Pearl Jam like some English phrase for something that we don't know or
or don't want to know?
No, it's not. And no, I don't. I'm more of a sort of Beethoven, Elgar, Bach sort of person, really. More refined.
Oh. I'll tell you this about the name. It's very similar to, there's a band that was called 10cc.
Mm-hmm. Remember them.
Yeah. And if you know what they're named after, Pearl Jam's very similar.
Look it up, kids. We'll stop
but
that
this,
one.
This story reminds me a little bit about, you know, when we bought, was it a brick in the new Jean Stadium or Levi Stadium, whatever the hell it's called?
The Field of Jeans.
But that's it, the Field of Jeans. That there's a brick somewhere in there from the 12th man, isn't there?
Mm-hmm,
or there's something. Yep. So this is like one of those stories where, like, you know, people can go, if you can get enough of yourselves together and you can purchase enough stock in the team, you know, it would be great if an opposing team could actually end up owning the Green Bay Packers and changing their name to like the Jalapenos or something. I don't know.
I want those fat Bears fans from the State Farm commercials to buy discount double check.
Yeah, George went. Yeah.
George went.
Oh, my God. I have to say, I do like them adverts, but I love them adverts. They make me smile. Yeah.
It's unfortunately, like when you buy stock now in the Packers, it is, you don't make any money, you don't get any dividends from the stock, and you have no voting power or anything. It's purely just a souvenir for you that you could say, I'm an owner. But they did that so that nobody could come in and buy all these shares and try to screw with the team.
They did that so Jerry Jones didn't come in and buy another team and screw that one up as well.
Well, screwing up the Cowboys is a full-time job, man.
You know, when you started a story, you said Aaron Rodgers has a new boss. I thought he was already married. So Whoa. All right. I had to throw that in there. Last one, Will. What do you got?
Well, Moses, DeMarco Murray is leading the league in rushing. He's the first player in league history to open a year with 7 straight 100-yard rushing games. He's just basically playing lights out right now. But give the man credit. He knows who to thank for it. And recently, Murray bought all 5 starting offensive linemen on the Cowboys free iMac desktop computers. So the computers retail for $1,300 each.
Ooh.
And, you know, usually when you hear stories about this sort of thing, they do it at the end of the year. But I guess Murray just wants to make sure the people blocking for him and making this all possible just realize how much he appreciates it.
Well, that's awful nice. He bought some iMacs. Matt, would you be excited about that if you got an iMac?
Can I play Minecraft on it?
I don't know. I don't have one. Yeah. So probably.
You know, if I can't continue my video chain, if I can't make Double Space Program videos or Minecraft videos on it, then I'm not interested. And I'm not going to be honest with you, buying me a computer is not going to really help me if I'm sort of like one of your blockers, to be frankly honest, because if I've spent too much time on there, you know, tapping away, looking at dodgy websites, I'm not really focused on my training. So, you know, I'm not going to block for you very well. I think it's a bad idea. I think you should just buy them a supply of it. I think you should just buy them a supply of Adderall and be done with it. That's what he should have done.
Well, hey, Mark, do you remember when, was it Dan Marino had the commercial where he bought isotoner gloves for all his linemen?
Yeah, which, of course, he didn't actually buy. Isotoner gave him to give to his linemen.
Exactly.
I mean, that's always kind of a tradition, is that the quarterback always, you know, it takes out his linemen.
Exactly.
You know, and I have to say, with DeMarco Murray, I would take him out to dinner if I could, because I got him in the 5th round of my fantasy league. So he has been, especially since LeSean McCoy has not exactly taken off there and kind of struggling with my quarterbacks, it's been great to have Murray. So.
It must be nice. I'm 2-5, so I can't even go in.
Yeah, I started out as I started like 3-0, and I lost 2 out of the last 3. You guys will appreciate that my fantasy team is called Super Bowl, 48 Gods.
Super Bowl 48 Gods. Minor the Pump Monkeys.
The commissioner of my league's a Niner fan, so I
I would have done something like that with a Niner fan, too. Will, what would you buy for somebody if you had a great football season?
Well, it kind of depends who I was buying it for. I mean, if it was a Niner fan, I'd get them highlights of Seattle's last Super Bowl.
Oh, there you go. Perfect.
Motivation.
Perfect. What about you, Dustin? Would you buy something special if you were having a season like DeMarco Murray?
I got to say, I'm a little sentimental about all that, so I'd probably get something for my grandma to commemorate it. Yeah. She got me involved in all the Seahawks stuff. And I take her to a game every year, so I'd probably get some for her because she does a lot for me.
Well, God bless her. And God bless you for being such a good grandson.
If I was DeMarco Murray, I'd probably buy a camera crew to record all my best moments, because it's only going to happen one year. So you want to remember that.
No doubt, man.
No doubt.
Think about Chris Johnson a couple years ago. He had that 2,000-yard-plus season, right? Mm-hmm. And Adrian Peterson had something similar. What's happening the year after?
Mm-hmm.
Not much. Not
good
much.
Point. Good point.
Yeah. Chris Johnson is now CJ 0.85K.
Yeah, man. Dude, it kills their body. It's so much damage to their body. They can't continue like that. So
yeah,
they have to enjoy it while they can.
Yeah, and the Cowboys are running Murray so much this year, it's going to break him down sooner rather than later.
I think so, too.
I hope it breaks him down for the NFC playoffs when we play Dallas. That's what I hope.
Yeah, the 2,000-yard rushers, it kills the body, almost everyone, except for the first 2,000-yard rusher. And that just killed his ex-wife, so.
Thought you'd take a stab at that joke, Mark.
This is why he's an Emmy Award-winning Mark Tye Turner. My goodness.
Hey, OJ jokes are evergreen, and evergreen means they never go out of style.
Nice. Well, we can't go on forever. Will, thank you for the news.
No problem.
It's the end of the first quarter, bitches.
And we're going to take a quick break. We will be back with the second quarter. We're going to real briefly go over this game that we just had with the Rams, with the good, bad, and the ugly. And then halftime trivia. And also in the second quarter, two-minute warning, we have a very special edition of Headlines and Punchlines. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to the 12th Man Fan Jam on the Seahawk Positivity YouTube channel.
Time to musk up. Wow. Never ceases to amaze me. She gets a special cologne. It's called Sex Panther by Odeon. It's illegal in 9 countries. Yep. It's made with bits of real panther. So you know it's good.
It's quite pungent.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh, it's a formidable scent. Stings the nostrils. In a good way.
Yeah. They've done studies, you know. 60% of the time, it works every time.
That doesn't make sense.
Well, let's go see if we can make this little kitty purr.
And now it's time for the second quarter of the 12th Man Fan Jam. In the second quarter, we will be discussing the good. We will be discussing the bad. And we will be discussing the ugly of last week's game. Here to take you through the second quarter is once again our host, the self-appointed Reverend Moses of the St. Paul Allen Church of Seahawk Positivity.
Yes, thank you once again, Magic Voice, the 12th Man Fan Jam, and welcome back to the second quarter of a very special Panther edition of the 12th Man Fan Jam. We have Matt from England, we have Dustin, we have Will Shadowhawk, and we also have Mark Tye Turner, Emmy Award-winning Mark Tye Turner, an author of Notes from a 12th Man, Truly Biased History of the Seattle Seahawks, and a new book, Seattle Seahawks Super Season, Notes on a 12 on the Best Season in Seahawk History. Please go to Amazon, go to Walmart.com, check them out, get them, buy them. They're great books. I happen to have a copy of his first book here, The Notes from a 12 Man, and I thought I would go ahead and read a little excerpt, if that's okay with everybody, real quick before we go in the good and bad and the ugly about the Rams game. Okay. Let's see here. Okay, here we go. She slowly got on her knees and unzipped his Oh, I'm sorry. This is my book. This is Notes from a 12-inch Man. I apologize, everyone. Sorry. Wrong book. Notes from a 12-inch Man. That's mine. And I apologize for that.
Fabulous read, by the way.
Thank you. And I was...
I want to point out, though, that's fan fiction. That is not nonfiction like Mark's book.
I love you guys. Yeah, the cover's a lot different. So I don't know how I did that, but...
Just to say, Moses,
it's a pop-up book.
Yeah. Well, Mark's cover is from the waist up. This one's from the waist down.
Can I just say, in the new book, there's a piece in his new book where he talks about the Willoughby Arms in London, where we had our Super Bowl parties. And as soon as I read that, as I saw that, I was like, I was there. I'm in the book.
Right. Awesome.
Nice.
That's awesome.
I remember you talked about that on that post Super Bowl show. That was cool.
Yeah.
Fantastic night.
But I had to put you guys in there, so that was fun.
Wow. Hey, Mark, real quick.
It's appreciated.
Mark, real quick. You want to tell them what you're doing on TV right now?
Right this second?
Not right this second, but...
Yeah, well, so it's tell us about the webcam account.
No.
That's what you won the Emmy for.
He's doing a pop-up version of a TV show.
Yeah, I'm doing a If you know the show Naked and Afraid, I'm doing the pop-up edition of that show. Yes. All the fun factoids and all that good stuff.
And tell them about the Cambodia episode, which I love.
Oh, there's the episode from Cambodia, the woman on the show. If you know the show, if you're familiar at all, we take a man and a woman who have survival skills, but they're strangers to each other, and we stick them out in the middle of the nowhere all over the world in this location, and they got to be naked for 21 days and survive. But this episode had this woman who was from Denver. And when she was out there doing the survival, it was towards the end of the time that she was out there was when the Super Bowl was happening, and she was just miserable out there. So I made a joke about how she goes, she thinks she's miserable here. She should see all of her hometown folks back in Denver. They're getting whacked Seahawks
in the Super Bowl. I'm watching the show, and Mark's like, you got to watch the Cambodia episode. So I'm watching it, and that thing popped up, and I was laughing so hard. I'm like, good one, Mark. You got it.
Yep. I'm able to slip a few of those in there once in a while. Discovery. Yeah. Didn't have an issue with that one, which was great.
That's awesome.
And it was germane, too. I mean, the fact is, this woman was from Denver, and the Super Bowl was happening, because I was able to figure out the days, and I go, oh my God, she's freaking out here, and it's the same day as the Super Bowl going on back in the States.
I'm definitely going to look for that episode now.
That's excellent.
Yeah,
that's
awesome. The pop-up editions, which air usually on Wednesdays and Thursdays.
Late at night. I know here it's midnight. I don't know what time it is for you guys, but Dustin.
I'm up then.
Yes, Dustin, sir. You're up now. Give us something good from this Rams game. And let's just talk about the Rams game and just move on. But give us something good from the Rams game, please.
I'd say the second half offense, man. Mm-hmm. I know there's a lot of controversy with the Percy Harvin trade on Friday, and the Seahawks were in disarray. However, I was happy about it because I felt like they were forcing things to Percy. They were going against their identity. And in the second half, I felt like they found their identity. Mm-hmm. They're running the ball, and Russell Wilson was doing his thing. He had some passes in there that were freaking nice. 3 straight touchdowns there at the end of the game. And I think that was a big reason why the Rams decided to not punt there at the very end, because they were afraid Russell was going to get the ball again. And he was going to win the game. He was that dominant in the second half.
I agree.
That second half offense is just setting the tone for what we're going to see the rest of the season, in my opinion.
Totally. And Jeff Fisher said as much, too. He said he didn't want to give the ball back. That's why he did the fake, because he knew that Russell was going to bring the box back down and score at least a field goal, if not a touchdown.
I totally agree. Well, this Russell Wilson guy, he's pretty good, yes?
Oh, it's just too bad he's too short to ever succeed in the NFL.
Yeah.
Seriously, though, I mean, you look at what Wilson, the guy just keeps impressing. At least he keeps impressing people that haven't already written him off. It's just a shame that some of his best games have come in games where he ended up losing thanks to defense or special teams. Because I honestly, this game reminded me a lot of the divisional playoff game in Atlanta, where we looked so bad in the first half, then came back, and then let it all slip away in the last minute. So, I think I agree with Dustin. I think it's going to help the team not to have Harvin, not to have to cram a square peg into a round hole. They can just focus on what they do best.
I agree. Well, unfortunately, Matt, there was some bad Matt to go around. Was there?
There was some bad Matts, absolutely. The first half, if we're going to have the second half as the good, we really second half as good. We really should have the first half as the bad. Mm-hmm. It was awful. It's like we're two different teams. Mm-hmm. It's the lack of consistency between, you know, playing a full game of football and just suddenly finding massive inspiration and having Russell Wilson suddenly becoming, you know, not suddenly, but, you know, demonstrating why he is, in my opinion, an elite quarterback in the making. All of that happens in the second half, but the first half is devoid of those sorts of flashes of brilliance. The thing that I would say as another bad is a lack of really good pass rush.
Yes.
And, you know, there's zero sacks in this game. There's not enough pressure being put in. And it was, I was sort of sat there, and also this week, as one of the news stories, which Will didn't mention, obviously, was that Michael Sam was released. And it just got me thinking, like, you know, we've got to get something. I don't know what what Irvin is doing, but he's not really producing. There's no productivity that I'm seeing there. This our first pick from 2012. Not seeing anything coming from there. Do something different about that. But that's got to change. We need to bring pressure, and it's not there.
I agree.
Hey, well, Moses.
Yes.
I heard this stat. I can't verify its authenticity, but from the games I've seen, it wouldn't surprise me. I think it's been calculated that Seattle has gotten one quarterback hurry in the fourth quarter all year.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Damn.
That's scary.
Well, a couple things to what Matt said. One, the first series in the first half wasn't bad. That kind of worked out pretty well. So I wasn't.
What did they get for it?
Shit, that was the one where,
They got three, better than nothing.
Yeah. They drove downfield, they actually got some. But Irvin, on a second point here, he is not doing the same role he had in the first season he was here. He's not rushing the passer like he was. That's not what they're asking him to do. This year, he is he's a linebacker. He got filled in as a linebacker. Because of the injuries that have happened. So he had to switch to a different role. So you're not going to get a lot of production as far as pass rush from that if he has to go out and cover and or do things in coverage, which he's not necessarily used to. I feel like that dude has come a long ways based on how much experience he had before the Seahawks drafted him. I think the fact that he is not being brought up on negative plays is a testament to how much he's come along because he's not the most experienced guy out there. So if he's not doing bad things, that's still good for the Hawks. And he has room to grow, to become a better player to where he does things where he stands out in a positive light. So he might not be helping the team the way you want him to, but he's not hurting the team. That's my point.
The trade-off comes, Dustin, is who is now doing his job? Because, you know, this is the point, is that we're not getting the turnovers we want to see. We're not getting the interceptions we want to see. Why? Probably because we're not hurrying them. We're not pressuring them. We're not getting enough pressure on the quarterbacks for them to make mistakes. We're giving them plenty of time to sit in their pocket quite comfortably and do whatever they want to do. We've got to get back to, and I still say that we're missing a Red Bryant-type leader in that line.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just feel that that's also another hole that seems to be left vacant and hasn't really been picked up or filled by anybody. So
I don't agree. I don't agree with that. So I don't think it's Red Bryant that's missing. I want to say it's Chris Clemens that's missing, somebody that can rush passer. Red Bryant didn't play a whole lot last year.
Hey, Mark, fix the defense, will you?
Oh, sure, no problem. I'll do that. I'm actually befuddled like everyone else. I mean, yeah, we are missing a few people from last year. Excuse me, my runs a little, but and mentioned like Clinton McDonald, that was a, you know, turns out that might have been a really key loss for us there. But it's weird. I mean, we got all these turnovers last year. It kind of is similar to what happened back in the 80s. In 84, we had all these turnovers and we had such an amazing defense that year. And then in 85, we just did not get the turnovers and ended up going 8-8 that year. Amongst a lot of expectations. So I got faith that they can turn it around. I mean, we got a good crew there. You know, some people just have to step.
Oh, I think with
these injuries too. I mean, without Wagner, I mean, that's your heart of your linebacking unit right there. So that's pretty brutal. It is true that because of that, Irvin has had to kind of take a different role this year. So. Irvin's not getting suspended, so it's good.
Yeah. No suspense is good.
Just jinxed
clarify
it.
Though, 84 was the year when they went to the AFC Championship, right, where they played the Raiders?
No, that was 83, actually. 84 right. was the year that Kurt Warner was hurt in the first game of the season, and everybody thought, oh, we're going to be toast that year because we lost it, because Warner was the AFC Rookie of the Year before, and it set the team record first running back to run for over 1,000 yards with the Hawks. But yeah, he goes out the first game, but then Chuck Knox becomes Air Knox. There, he goes from Ground Chuck to Air Knox.
Mm-hmm.
Craig just put up these ungodly numbers, which put up. I forgot at the time how many touchdowns he threw, like 30 something touchdowns. But it was one of the highest total ever in the NFL at that point. The problem was it came at the same year as Moreno, who shattered the touchdown.
Right.
So he kind of went by the wayside with that, but. Yeah, and so it was an amazing season. And our defense was really what also helped us out. We were like ranked number one in takeaways by a long, you know, we had almost double the takeaways as the next closest team. It was like real special on that season. So
if I'm not mistaken,
this turnover.
If I'm not mistaken, that was the year of Dr. Dan, was it not?
Dr. Dan was definitely a big part of that team.
Oh, yes.
84 was the year Kenny Easley was named NFL Defensive Player of the Year.
Mm-hmm.
Had an amazing season, and we had three shutouts that year, too.
So crazy.
Including two back-to-back. So, yeah, they up until a couple of years ago, that was the – actually, 91 was the points record before this, but for a long time, that was the record for at least –
I guess it's my turn to go with ugly, and I take one thing here, and it's hard because that whole game was ugly, and I could talk about the fake punt, but I'll be honest with you, I was there, I was in the other end zone as they punted the ball away from me, and I had no idea what was going on until the kid was at the 20, so I was as fooled as everybody else, but for me, the ugly, it seems like a recurring theme, and we've kind of harped on this already. But I know Will brought this up a little bit. It's another game where our defense, who's had all these nicknames, who's had all these monikers, and to be honest, I like the way that the Legion of Boom, if you're referring to Thomas and Chancellor and Sherman, have played this year. I cannot complain about those three guys. But it has been a year where our defense has been asked to step up in the fourth quarter, and they could not do it again. And that, to me, is pretty ugly. I don't know how you guys feel about that.
Well, I was definitely disappointed. Yeah, that drive, that last – the Rams, when they went down the field and scored that last time, I mean, it was like they really needed the defense to be selling out on this. And they had done a pretty good job most of the second half. I mean, shut them down pretty good, but then they let Austin Davis –
I know.
People.
I know. I like the next breeze.
Yeah, I feel like the pass rush really isn't getting home. Mm-hmm. And that's causing a huge problem.
Yes.
And I know you said that Cam, you don't have any disappointment in his play, but I think his injuries are kind of showing that he's not the same dude.
Yeah.
I mean, when was the last time you saw Cam make a big hit and everybody's like, oh my God, Cam Chancellor just blew that guy up. I feel like he's a half a step behind because of his injury. His ankle is an issue. So
yeah, he looks like he's at 70%.
Yeah, and it's obvious.
Yeah.
Well, and Moses, you want to talk about ugly in defense? I got two words for you: Thurold Simon.
Oh,
I mean, this is a guy who got kicked out of a preseason game. Okay, comes into this game and gets called on a bad pass interference penalty. Almost gets called for a unnecessary roughness penalty and only dodges that because Brian Quick was dumb enough to throw a punch at him. Comes back on the very next play and gets called for unnecessary roughness for ripping the guy's helmet off. Now, Byron Maxwell is out this week, which means Simon is going to get his start. When is this kid going to grow up?
Well, and this is the only kid on draft day. I had two names I didn't want, and he was one because he's the kid on draft day that said, I own this town, and this town belongs to me. And I'm like, I don't want this kid on my team. Guess what? Guess who we drafted, Matt?
Yeah, disappointing. And as I said, I mean, anyone, who the hell gets thrown out of a preseason game?
Right.
Who the hell gets thrown out of a preseason game?
I know. They're old Simon.
I like you better. You're sober, Dustin. I do. It's just mind-boggling, though, isn't it? Because I watched it as well, and I thought, you know, walk away, be a little bit. These have got to get a bit more. And we come back to penalties, incidentally, which I think there was 12 in total in this game across both of these, 10 for us at least. But we've got to get this penalty thing under control, because the competition part of this team, I understand, I get that, I think that's a necessary part. I understand that we're going to play physical football. I understand that they've brought in a load of new rules, probably unnecessarily, which we're going to get flags on, and I get that. But a lot of this scrimmage, this holding, this obvious, you know, stuff which is pretty old school, actually, these aren't new rules, these are old rules, and we're still breaking them. Can we get those under control, please? These line of scrimmage penalties have got to stop.
The Thurold Simon thing doesn't bother me. I mean, you can't teach aggression. You can't teach size. You can't teach speed. You can't teach composure, work on that, and you can't teach technique. He's missing, and as you get older, maturity happens. He's missing maturity, technique, and composure.
But he's copying he can learn games. Those. But you know what? I'm sorry. This kid is not a kid. He's a professional football player, and everyone else has the same issues. This dude cost us a touchdown in the opening quarter with his stupidity. And he got all kicked right. out of preseason with his stupidity. And what on the day like? Of draft day, wait a minute, on draft day, he was stupid. So, dude, he needs to grow up right now. I mean, if you want to get paid millions of dollars to play this game, then grow up.
If you're 22, 23 years old, you're going to
play
mature.
Football. Then don't play football.
Oh, okay? I didn't because mostly because I'm not good. But
well, okay. But the dude don't have to play football. The dude can go work at McDonald's.
Moses, tell us how you really think about.
Well, he is no yeah. the kid. I'm sorry, the kid. Well, he's going to grow up someday. No, he's getting paid to grow up now, and he cost our team. And I will tell you, I know they probably didn't show it on TV, but after he did his stupid stuff, he got Sherman in his face, he got Chancellor in his face, and then he was out the rest of the game. They ain't putting up with that crap, and I'm not going to either.
Well, that's good that they did that. I mean,
somebody needs to.
Yeah, that which is good. I think that will, you know, hopefully that will mature this kid. And
yeah, don't give me this poor
kid
babes in the woods crap.
No. It's a whole new thing when you're going up there. And that is a teaching point. And Sherm and Cam and those guys took it as that. And they are trying to push him in the right direction. I'm sure they wouldn't put out that effort and try and push that point on him if they didn't see the potential. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, sure. I think the thing to remember as well at the end of the day is that really this kid should be learning this on the practice field and not on the actual playing
Fine.
Field. This is the point.
He can mature
You know, if Byron Maxwell was playing out there, Farrell Simon wouldn't be having any of these issues. He'd be learning and growing up on the practice field. That's not happening. It's happening on the main field, which means it's got to happen quicker. And that comes back down to the coaching again. And there are, you know, with the rumors that have been going around about the Seahawks and the locker room and all this sort of stuff, if ever Carroll and the other coaches need to, you know, knuckle down and do proper work, so to speak, then now is the time.
Yeah. I agree. And
so,
I think,
so you're saying Therrell Simon is too black. Is that what you're saying?
oh, ouch. Ooh, new show, everybody.
Yeah.
Moving on.
Moving on.
Edit. Yeah.
That is, if you want to address that to Dustin, that would be Dustin.
Dustin, care of
12manfanjam@gmail.com. Dustin. Okay. I think we will, on that note, we will go to the two-minute warning.
Holy sh! It's a two-minute warning!
Yes, we are now in our two-minute warning, and as promised, we will take a headline from the NFL and add our own little punchlines to it, and a little thing we like to call headlines and punchlines. Yes, headlines and punchlines. Our headline and punchline for this evening is the following. Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday. It was quite a feat, history making. I know I have a couple. Will,
I've got two.
Oh, Matt's got two.
I've got three.
Mark has one. Dustin has two. And Will?
I've got three.
See. Will always is the suck up of the group. Here we go. Okay.
I'm not bringing it here. I only have one.
Whatever.
But you're the only one that's ever gotten awards for your writing. Here we go. We'll start with Matt. Matt.
Right. Yes.
Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
Those stats are definitely black and white enough for me.
Very nice. That was nice. Dustin, Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
Thinking half the locker room, thinking if he was blacker, he would have run for more yards.
That's Dustin again, everybody.
You're just determined to push that one, aren't you?
Yes. Dustin, everybody.
You know what's weird is I'm highly offended by all this, but I will definitely put jokes... I will put the jokes in there because it's so, to me, it's stupid. I got more for later too. It's gonna come up later, so no worries.
New show. New show. Yep. Will, save us. Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards, threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
Insert Chuck Norris style joke here.
Nice.
Oh, brilliant. Mark, Russell Wilson.
Threw up 300 yards after that fake punt.
Didn't we all? Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
I threw up 300.
Oh,
you said the punchline. Yards after that fake punt.
Timing. All right.
I botched it there. I did it. I did the line before you actually.
Didn't get an Emmy for timing. He didn't get an Emmy for timing.
Take two.
That's all right. I've only got two.
That's a fine. You can fix that in post.
We can fix that.
Fine job on my part.
That's all right. My turn. Russell Wilson ran for the 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday. He also discovered the meaning of life at halftime. So we've got that to look forward to. The guy's kind of brilliant. Yes. Matt.
Yes.
Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
Seahawks should sit Russell Wilson and start Matt Flynn. Michael Lombardi, October the 2nd, 2012.
Nice, man. Woo! That's so good.
Nice. All right, Will. Will, Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
CBS Sports contributor and frequent Wilson detractor Pete Briscoe, hardest hit.
I'm going to do one more. Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday. He also caused the Rams to fumble using his mind.
Mm-hmm. Hey, yeah.
Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards and threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
And the bandwagon didn't notice because they were all busy watching the Jets game.
Yay! All
right.
Yay! Finally, Will. Take us home, Will. Russell Wilson ran for 100 yards, threw for 300 yards against the Rams last Sunday.
And if he could just play special teams, we'd be 4-2 right now.
There it is! The kids loved it! Oh, God, I think we're at halftime, finally.
Holy sh! It's halftime.
Let's take a quick halftime break, station identification, and get ready for a special play-along version of Carolina Panther trivia. You're not going to want to miss that. We'll be right back after this.
Hey, this is Matt, all the way from merry old England, and you're listening to the 12th Man Fan Jam.
Yes, welcome to another rousing halftime edition version of 12th Man Fan Jam Halftime Trivia. Yes, halftime trivia, where you, the listener, can play along as well. We've got such an action-packed group of 12th Man Posse here to play this game. And you can play along for fabulous prizes chosen especially for you. So let's not waste any more time. Let's get right into the guests and the competitors. First, our guest of honor this evening, Mr. Matlock theme. He knows why. From California, Emmy Award winning, Mark Tye Turner.
Guest of honor. Wow. It's an honor to be a guest of honor, I guess.
Yes. We like to honor our guests of honors with honor.
Thank you. And that's the Matlock theme.
And that's the Matlock theme, just for you. And you know why.
Which, if for people don't know, like when you read my book, that you'll figure it, you'll know
all about
the Matlock theme. But it's a foot Seahawk touchdown dance that
a little. Yep.
A group of guys, Seahawk fans, I watch the games with now, this group of Washingtonians, actually. We all watch the games, and this is their stupid thing that they've started a few years ago, but it's really funny, actually, now. It's just like, doesn't make a lot of sense, but, you know, it's very 12th man.
Well, how many traditions and superstitions make sense? That's the thing.
Yeah, that's true.
Very few.
It's only weird if it doesn't work.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Speaking of weird if it doesn't work, I was told this person needed his intro, so... From the state of Washington. A defending champion at one point and second place winner
long
for
ago.
Many times. He is the Shadowhawk, Will.
King of the Mullet.
Say hi, Will.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. I was told if I didn't play the Sammy Hagar winner takes it all, he would not win. So he has no excuse tonight. Oh, the hair. Oh, you should see the hair of Sammy. All right. We'll move on. And once again, we want to remind you that is a soundtrack song from a movie about arm wrestling. Okay.
Was that over the top?
Over the top.
Over the top.
Yeah. Was that over the top? That was definitely over the top.
Nice.
And a champion among champions for merry old England. God save the Queen, baby.
God save the Queen.
He is Matt.
Yeah.
Say hi to everyone, Matt.
Hi, everybody.
All right.
God save the Queen. In the morning, God save the
Queen. All right, enough of that.
God save the Queen.
God save the Queen. We mean it, man. And our final contestant.
Hi-ho! Hi-ho!
Our own little dwarf. He often works in Christmas time as the Christmas elf. He is Dustin. Dustin. Hi-ho, Dustin.
I prefer to think of myself as an Oompa Loompa personally, but
that's
fine.
Well, you know, the song can always change.
Puzzle for you.
All right. Here's how the game's played. You have two rounds of questions. Each question is worth a point, and then there's a final question that is a number you have to get the closest to without going over for 2 points. At the end of that round, anyone who's tied will go into a nail-biting overtime, which we've had before. So it's very exciting. The topic is Panthers trivia and Carolina trivia. Oh, it says Panthers trivia all the way through, basically. We will ask our guest. Well, actually, our champion's not here. And if you will play along at home, you can play along at home because we put the questions and the answers up on the screen as our contestants are participating. We want to remind you there are a couple rules. Please no Googling. Can't Google anything. No phone a friend, especially for Matt, because it's 4 a.m. And finally, no wagering, because this is just for fun. Now, here's what I did today. I took my two lovely children, little Mo and Mosette. You see them on the screen right now. My two children, and they're on fall break. So I asked them these questions that you're about to be asked. And after I get your answer, I will tell you what they said and if they were right or not. So we'll see if you can beat some kids at this game. So. Let's see.
Damn, I feel like we're being set up for one of those. Well, are you smarter than a fifth grader?
Are you smarter than little Mo and Mosette? Mosette, by the way, our voice at the break saying us, telling us, holy cow, it's halftime and all that. That's Mosette. Okay. We will start with our guest, Mark. Mark, you have question 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You get to pick, Mark.
Let's go 5.
Mark's going to go 5. Then we go with Matt.
3.
Matt will go with 3, then we will go with Will.
I'll take 4.
And Dustin, 1 or 2?
1.
Dustin will take 1, okay. Here we go. Dustin, your question is the following. The Carolina Panthers have been in the NFL for 19 years. How many seasons have they posted a record better than 500? Was it 5, 6, or 7 times? Hey, Dustin.
Yes, sir.
Oh, no.
She's back, baby. We got Oregon.
Oh.
I'm giving you the Oregon. 19 seasons. How many over 500 for the Panthers? 5, 6, or 7?
I don't know. I kind of want to hear what Fiona has to say.
You want to hear what the kids said?
Yeah.
The kids picked 6B. Both of them.
Huh. All right, well, before you gave options, I thought 5, so I'm going to go with 5.
So he's going to go with 5.
Yeah.
And 5 is right.
Yeah.
Dustin is on the board.
Yeah, yay.
With 1.
I would have gone with 6 myself.
Yeah. I'd have gone with 6 as well.
Yeah. 5 times over 500.
Yeah. Crazy.
All right, Matt.
Hello.
Hello. In the Carolina's first draft pick was quarterback Kerry Collins. What college did Kerry Collins play for? You love these college questions.
Oh!
What college did Kerry Collins play for? Is it Pitt, Penn State or Maryland.
Oh, is that an option? Sorry.
Penn State is an option. Did you pick it?
That's the word just came out of my mouth.
The kids both picked A, by the way.
I feel like you knew that.
The kids both picked A, and however you're right! Penn State!
Yeah. That was like one of those subconscious answers.
Awesome. This is the only college I know. And it's all for the wrong reasons. I know.
Oxford. It was Oxford. Yeah.
All right.
Kerry Collins, by the way, if you guys don't know the story, he early on in his career, he was drunk one night. He made some kind of racially insensitive remarks there. I don't know if anybody ever remembers this, but after that, he was... A couple of friends of mine gave him the nickname Kerry Klansman after that.
Oh, wow. Beautiful. I know how those drunken nights go.
Will, here we go. Are you ready? Everyone's answered it right so far. Okay, because of so many office and players from a certain team, the first season, the 1995 Carolina Panthers, were often called what? The Colts of the East, the Patriots of the South, or the Bills of the South?
Hmm.
1995 Panthers. The Colts of the East, the Patriots of the South, or the Bills of the South? They had a lot of guys, four players, and a GM that were all from this other team. So they called them either the Colts of the East, the Patriots of the South, or the Bills of the South.
Let's see. I will go with Colts.
The kids got this one right, by the way, both of them.
Can I answer? I think it was the Bills, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was going to go Bills, too.
And the answer...
I was going Patriots.
Yeah, I'm sorry. It is the Bills of the South. Bills of the South.
Bill Pullian was there.
Bill Pullian and
Frank Reich.
And wide receiver Don Beebe. Tight end Pete Metzelaars and linebacker Carlton Bailey, all from the Bills. So they call him the Bills in the South.
Former Seahawk tight end as well, Pete Metzelaars.
Oh, yes. That's true. That's very true.
Briefly.
All right, Mark.
I did not know that.
I think Mark's going to get this. I think Mark's going to roll on this, but we're going to ask him anyway.
That's because Mark knows everything.
I don't
By the way, Will, the kids got that one right and you didn't. Okay.
You mentioned that. Yes. Thank you, Moses.
I'm sorry. Can you say that again? What was that? I missed it.
Mark, in the first season... What division did the Panthers play in? Was the NFC South, the NFC Central, or the NFC West?
Oh, it was the NFC West.
It was the NFC West, he says.
Yeah, that's true. It's goofy the way it was all lined up.
And he's right, NFC West.
Because that was pre-realignment.
And Little Mo got that one.
They had Atlanta in that division, too.
Yeah.
How in the hell does that make sense?
Yeah, because when three of the teams were in the South... You got to remember that the Falcons and the Saints were in the NFC West forever. It wasn't until they did all the realignment in 2002.
That's true.
So you can imagine, like, kids that are growing up, their geography is screwed up totally if they're following just the NFL.
I missed a lot while I was away at basic training. I tell you what, I had no idea.
Well, wow. Here's what we've got right now. Everyone's got a point, but Will, as we go to the second round, but Will is definitely not out of it. We will start with questions 6 through 10. Mark, what question would you like?
I'll take 7.
Mark will take 7. Matt, what question would you like?
10, please.
10. And Dustin, what question would you like?
8.
8. And finally, Will?
I'll take 6.
Will will take 6, so he will start our second round. Okay, Will. I'd say you need this, but the final one's worth 10 points or 2 points, and you know that. So, in the remake of the movie The Pink Panther,
oh dear,
great!
Who played the role of an Inspector Clouseau? Was it Steve Martin, Robin Williams, or Kevin Kline?
Steve Martin.
Steve Martin, he says.
It's a bum.
My
I feel like that's a good guess.
That is correct, I believe.
Can I say that the kids missed this one? And yep, you got it. Steve Martin.
Ben.
Good one.
Yay.
Yep,
I'm guessing the kids said Robin Williams because that's the only name they knew, right?
You know, let's see. The kids did say, Robin Williams. Yeah, they said Robin Williams.
Yeah.
They definitely wouldn't be saying Kevin Kline.
Yeah, they probably don't know who that is.
No.
Actually, the truth is Kevin Kline was Robin Williams were considered for that part, but they didn't get it. Mark, Yes, we'll take you back a little farther to the original Pink Panther. The original Pink Panther in 1963. What was the Pink Panther? Was it a bandit, a diamond, or a cat?
It was a diamond, I believe.
Mark believes it was a diamond. And he's right. It was a diamond.
Woo!
Mark is leading 2-1.
Anybody know who directed that film?
Blake Edwards. Blake Edwards.
That's very good. Very good.
Woody Harrelson? Yes.
Blake Edwards, exactly. Yeah.
Kids missed that one, too. All right. They thought it was a cat. Of course, kids would think that. All right, Dustin.
Yeah.
Which of the following actors was in the 1995 Mario Van Peebles film Panther? Who was in the film Panther about the Black Panthers? Was it Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy, or Chris Tucker? It's fitting that you get this question, by the way. But
how so?
Who was in the 1995 Mario Van Peebles film Panther? Was it Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy, or Chris Tucker?
I feel like Pryor was dead. I don't think he was in that. And
that would make it difficult.
Yeah.
Are you getting enough organ?
Yeah, it's okay. Making it hard to think, man. I'm trying to do this.
Eddie Murphy or Chris Tucker is what you're down to.
Tucker was in Friday. I don't feel like that was a very famous movie. Chris Tucker.
Chris Tucker, he says. Kids both got this wrong. But you didn't.
Oh,
it's Chris
wow.
Tucker.
Yeah.
And Dustin has two. And hangs on with the lead with Mark. Now it comes down to Matt.
I will tell you, though, that Richard Pryor was alive at that point. Richard Pryor didn't die until 2005.
Exactly.
I know this because died about 3 miles from me.
Oh.
I knew there was like a 5 in there. So.
Do you have an alibi, Mark?
Oh, boo.
Nice.
All right.
That's a different show. Different show.
Yes. And the last question before we go to our final question belongs to Matt. Matt, no.
Yes.
Matt, what weapon does Panthro use in the show Thundercats?
Oh, I know this. Come on,
nunchucks. Nunchucks, daggers, or mace?
Nunchucks. Red one and blue one.
How do you know that?
I'm a huge fan of Thundercats.
Oh.
Yep.
Who doesn't know Thundercats?
Nunchucks. The kids didn't even get that right.
That's from SNL, right?
Yeah, they didn't realize that Thundercats were on the loose and Thundercats are raw. They didn't know that.
Oh dear.
Oh my God. All right.
I used to call my sister Mumra.
No, why does that not surprise me?
Oh my God.
That's one of the TV series that I bought. Like my kids are now, they're 11, and that's one of the series that growing up I loved. So I bought Thundercats. I bought Transformers about G.I. Joe.
Nice.
All the
nice.
Series, and we've watched all
yourself.
Of those episodes.
Yeah. All for yourself.
All for yourself.
Selfishly for myself, but I remember right. kids watching, they like them too.
All right, it's time to go to the final question. Here's how the final questions work. You will be given a final question, and whoever's the closest without going over will get 2 points. So, everyone's still very much alive in this game. So, Dustin has 2. Matt has 2, Mark has 2, and Will has 1. So, your final Jeopardy question. Jeopardy question? Your final halftime trivia question. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Your final question is this, and we'll start with Matt. What are the most points that the Panthers have ever scored against the Seahawks in a game? The highest number of points the Panthers have ever scored against the Seahawks in any game. All right, here we go.
Oh, I've got
Matt,
a clue.
What do you say?
25.
Dustin.
What?
Dustin, the most points the Panthers have ever scored against the Seahawks in a game.
Um, I think they got 17 in the championship game. I want to say they probably scored more. I'm going to go 21.
21. Mark.
I think I have to go back to the first game we ever played on there. And it was where was that? I think that was around 2000. Crappy game.
2000 points.
We scored. I think they scored. I think it was weird because it was a weird score. I think it was, I'll go with 26. It was like a weird score. Like I think Mark, we lost 26-3 or something like that. It was really ugly.
Will?
Yeah, that actually has the distinction of being the one game that Brock Heward managed to finish when he was starting here.
Oh, he knows and, this, apparently.
Well, you took my answer, Mark, so I'm going to go with 23.
Cheater. Cheater.
Okay. 21, 23, 25, and 26. One of you is right on the buzzer. The most points the Panthers have ever scored against the Seahawks is 26! And Mark!
Yes, what a Mark.
And Matlock wins again!
Yes! Yay! And the crowd goes
Matlock
wild.
Matlock, and the crowd goes wild! Mark nice. Solidifies himself as one of the most knowledgeable fans. You have a speech, Mark?
I'm just being bathed in great imaginary gifts right now. So
you are.
Cash and prizes.
Absolutely.
It's awesome.
It's amazing. And you've got the Matlock theme behind you.
Yeah.
So what can you possibly go wrong with the Matlock theme?
Since we're on the trivia here, I want to give you guys a little trivia, a little factoid that's kind of interesting about Sunday's game.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Ready?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Oh, somebody said, okay, sorry. I actually tweeted about this earlier as I discovered. Because the game on Sunday is actually on CBS. I don't know if you guys know that.
No.
Which
yeah,
is,
they switched it.
They That's switched weird. It there, which is weird because it's us playing the Panthers. And normally,
yeah.
Intra-conference games like that are always on Fox.
Fox, yeah.
But right. Because of this new flex schedule and everything and with the Thursday night games and all that stuff. Sometimes they move games to the other network. I think
wow.
Fox took an AFC game a few
Weird.
Weeks ago. So Sunday will be the Seahawks' first intra-conference game since 1976.
Wow!
Since Woo. That first year that we came into the league in the NFC.
That's the inaugural season. That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's
so how's that? That's a goofy little trivia there for you.
That is goofy. Wow. That's pretty awesome. So,
let's hope we have better luck this year than in 76.
Almost as good as the Matlock theme itself. But not
we
quite.
We did miss we missed one honor from this whole quiz. We missed one honor out, and that's that Will was the only person to get beaten by the kids.
Yes!
Yeah.
Will got beat by the kids.
True.
Well,
I also
gonna...
knew the right answer. It's just Mark beat me to it.
Yes, you did.
That's true.
And I misquoted the Thundercats theme song, too. I just want to throw that out there. That was
all right. Fair enough. We will take a break. We will come back, start the third period after this quick identification.
You're listening to the 12th Man Fan Jam on the Seahawk Positivity YouTube channel.
Soft kitty, warm kitty,
soft kitty, warm kitty, little ball of fur,
kitty,
happy kitty, sleepy kitty, purr, purr, purr.
It's the third quarter, bitches.
Yes, it is the start of the third quarter. After an exciting halftime trivia competition that saw our guest, Emmy Award-winning Mark Tye Turner, author of two wonderful 12th Man books, defend his knowledge of the 12th Man and the Seahawks by cruising to a victory. Congratulations again, Mark, and thanks for being on the show.
Thank you. I wasn't really cruising. That was a tough one. Everybody was getting all of them.
It was. So, it was. I had made them
it was
really
very competitive.
Hard. See, everybody's complaining, and now everybody's getting the questions right, so I'm going to do something later. But anyway... We're going to move on to the third quarter. We're going to talk about injuries with Medic Matt. Matt, what kind of injuries are we looking at in this game that may affect this game?
Okay, there are two major headlines, okay, with injuries this week. Two major headlines. The first one is that for the Seahawks, everybody of any consequence who might actually help us win this game is injured.
Boo.
You know, honestly, we've got four cheerleaders out. I mean, they've got broken ankles.
That really hurts.
They were warming up with Derek Coleman, and the whole thing has just gone to pot from there, really. So he's out with, like, I think he broke his spine or something during a full warm-up or something. I don't know. That's pretty serious.
Oh, Lord.
Jordan Hill has got a broken fingernail. He can't play. Maxwell got a little bit of dirt in his eye earlier. He can't play. Zach Miller got a splinter off the bench, so he can't play. Max Unger's got a toothache, so he's going to have to be out. He got a note from his mum and everything, so that's like not going to happen.
Wait, was it signed Max Unger's mom? That's what
yeah,
I mean.
It was. Okay, it was Mrs. Unger.
My God.
Bobby Wagner, seriously, we don't know what's happened to him. We think he's been abducted by aliens, but we're not sure. Brian Walters is also out, but we just think he's got a bit of a sort of a slight abrasion on the arm. That shouldn't be too much of a problem, but we are going to let him sit out this one. But the good news is that Farrell Simon is in, so obviously that's going to help everybody.
Oh, dear.
God. Oh, my.
Just to clarify, the one medical term there, an abrasion for Brian Walters, it's a scratch. Yeah, just so you know,
it's just a flesh wound.
That's the first headline. The second headline about the whole of this injury situation is far more serious. There is actually somebody called Fozzie Whitaker on the Panthers team, and as soon as I read it, all I wanted to do was go waka waka waka.
Oh, hi.
I know. I thought you were talking about the Muppet Babies there for a second. I thought I was waiting for the punchline.
It was the Muppet, but it is Wacka Wacka Wacka. It's Fozzie Bear is a running back, and he's out. Oh my God! Somebody drafted Fozzie Bear.
Wow.
Well, you should have seen his 40 time at the combine, Matt.
Well, Mel Kiper did say though that if this is the only time he's going to see Fozzie Bear get a chance in the league, and if he doesn't get it done, then he doesn't want to hear about bears in the league ever again.
Hey, Fozzie, run the ball.
Gruden loved the guy though.
Fozzie, run
Gruden
the ball.
Gruden loved him. Starting to piss me off. Yeah.
Wait. Hey, Fozzie.
Everyone's injured. D'Angelo Williams is injured as well for the Panthers. I mean, in fact, this is like a hospital game. It's like two hospital wards are emptying out in the middle of the field on Sunday. They're going to come out with Zimmer frames and walkers and all this sort of stuff. Oh, and I've also just got news in that Pete Carroll has got a slight chewing gum injury in the jaw, but he's going to cut down. He's cutting down to three packs of chewing gum for this game rather than the standard five.
Grief. Everybody's hurt.
Wow.
Fozzie, run the ball.
Go, waka.
Waka, waka.
Waka, waka.
Go, waka.
There it is. All right. Fozzie, run the bear. Mark, my God. Can we get any more injuries? What's going on?
Yeah, it's football. This is what happens. You know, we were pretty lucky last year. So,
yeah.
You know.
We were. Dustin, God, so many injuries. And the thing is, statistically, you know, the Panthers just have not had a good year. Statistically, you look at this team and you say, oh, they're like the bottom half on offense and defense. They're only rushing. This is a team that loves to run the ball, 90 yards a game, 27th in the league. They're 26th against the run. Their defense is what they usually – they're 27th in the league overall defensively. I mean, this is not a very good Panther team, is it?
No, to be honest with you, I had not paid attention much to this team. Yeah. I knew they were the top of their division. And then this last week, I started looking into it, and I found out they're terrible against the pass. Terrible against the run.
Yep.
And then I knew their running backs were hurt all year long. So I felt like, you know what? The Seahawks have a chance to come back here, even though it's on the East Coast. And really, really assert themselves.
Yes.
And I feel like they're going to do that. I mean, everything is set up to where the Seahawks can succeed here. I thought the Panthers were much, much better than they were. And happily mistaken, honestly.
Interesting. Go ahead, Dustin. I'm sorry.
No, I'm just saying I was happily mistaken because from the here's where I fell into the loop where I would see things here and there about Panthers leading their division, the Panthers doing this, doing that. I thought they were a good team.
Yeah.
So I didn't give them a second thought until this week, and I looked into it and I was like, oh, they're not a good team.
Yeah, they're leading their division. So
unbelievable.
But their whole
division. Yeah, but somebody has to.
Well, the whole division's a disaster right now. I mean, look at New Orleans. Yes. They're 2-4.
Yes. Exactly.
Tampa Bay's won exactly one game. Atlanta's 2-4, I believe. So, yeah, the whole division is not good. But as far as I'll tell you, one thing with the Seahawks, I will give faith that, you know, I mean, Max Unger's the man, but we do have a good replacement. I mean, Stephen Schilling, who I will mention is a Bellevue High School graduate, just like myself. Yeah. So, even praise him. It's the first time a Bellevue Wolverine has actually played for the Seahawks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
he has a copy of my first book. I know that.
Oh, good.
Because I signed one for his dad to give to him last year.
Dennis,
his dad's one of the managers of the Costco in Kirkland, so I was up there doing a book signing.
Okay. Dennis, well, he's a third stringer, so it kind of leaves room to be worried, you know?
Matt, what you got?
Got another injury just coming, actually. Apparently, Colin Kaepernick is out with a torn vagina.
Well, it wasn't torn. Nice. There's some sand in there.
Yeah.
And they have to... Oof. You got to go in there with the saline bag. You got to spray it out, and he's questionable. So, we'll see how it goes.
Hey, Will?
Yes?
How do you feel about this game? I mean, statistically, your Panthers are not that good. Everyone's beat up. Both sides are injured. What do you see as the key to this game?
Well, key to this game, we got to take advantage. They're hurting on both the offensive and defensive lines. I mean, I think we're seeing just how valuable a player Greg Hardy has been to them. And it's too bad he's such a dick in real life. But, I mean, on the field, he was great. But, yeah, we got to win the line of scrimmage. And I really think we can with how depleted they are. And I got to say, it's going to be interesting because with Brian Walters out, they're going to have Paul Richardson returning punts. So it'd be nice if that turned out to be a pleasant surprise.
I thought Baldwin was doing punts. Is Richardson doing punts?
Baldwin's doing kickoffs. Richardson's going to do punts.
Oh, yeah, really? We'll see how that
interesting.
Goes.
Yes.
Because Baldwin did a decent job for us last year as a punt returner.
I think so, too.
Well, Baldwin actually was doing kickoffs.
Championship.
Yeah, Baldwin, that was actually a kickoff. He was doing kickoffs.
Oh, was that the kickoff?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought he had done a punt return. Or maybe I must be mistaken. Golden was doing most of the punt returns.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Final five games, last five games for the Panthers, they have given up the following: 37 points, 38 points, 24 points, 37 points, and 38 points. This is a team, and that's on the road, that's at home. This is just a not really good team right now. Even though they are home, this is not the team that we saw last year, I don't think.
Yeah, that's shocking. They were the second. I think they had the lowest amount of points scored against them last year, next only us. So.
Yes, yes. And that's what they base themselves on. So we'll see how it goes.
One of the things I would say just on this is that this was one of the games I had down as one of our losses for this year. If you remember at the beginning of the season, we had our predictions about how we would go, and I was 13-3. But this was one of them. The Chargers was one. This was another one. Unfortunately, we've already had my three losses this year, so I'm sort of out of picks. But I actually had them down as, you know, would be better than what they've shown. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Me too. Well, we'll take a quick break. That's the end of the third quarter.
It's the end of the third quarter, bitches.
And we'll take a quick break here and come back with our predictions, our prognostications, and our game balls right after this quick station identification.
You're listening to the 12th Man Fan Jam on the Seahawk Positivity YouTube channel.
It's tough love, just like my Mitchell Kitty. When he's bad, I say, "That's a bad Mitchell Kitty," and I smack him on the head.
And now, it's time for the fourth quarter of the 12th Man Fan Jam. Here to lead us through the final quarter is once again our host, the self-appointed Reverend Moses of the St. Paul Allen Church of Seahawk Positivity.
Yes, thank you, Magic Voice of 12th Man Fan Jam. Welcome to the fourth and final quarter of a very special Panther version of the 12th Man Fan Jam. We've been joined by a special guest, Mark Tye Turner, and his Seahawk books. If you don't have them, please, Amazon.com, Walmart.com. Look up Mark Tye Turner. Look up the Seahawk books. They are fantastic. Mark, thanks again for joining us.
For having me, guys.
This is the fourth quarter. We usually do our prediction, our prognostication, and our game ball. So what we need from you, Mark, is a score, a prognostication, some stat that's going to stand out at the end of the game or some event that's going to happen in the game that's maybe a little unusual, or some stat for the teams, or a game ball as well. So what do you have for us this evening?
Well, I was originally thinking maybe 24 or 27, but since you've been reciting off, the Panthers have been giving up over 30 a game. I'm going to go with a 31-13 final Seahawks.
Nice.
And I think this is the week that Beast Mode turns things around. I think he gains more yards than he take any other three games combined, and he'll pull that tally. I'm thinking he's going to go for 140
nice.
At least this week. I just think – I know the – offensive line is still a little beat up, but I just see them going back to the style that got us to the Super Bowl last year. So I think, excellent. The guy has not run for over 100 yards yet this season. Get on track. Even though the Panthers defense, they're still formidable as much as they give up a lot of points there, but I still think Beast Mode, maybe I'll even go, I'll go 170 total yards in receiving and rushing.
Wow, excellent. And I guess he's your game ball, obviously.
Yep.
Yeah, all right. Excellent. Well done. Dustin.
Sir?
You have a score, a prognostication, and a game ball for us.
Sure. 28-17 Hawks, 4 picks. I feel like that Sherman's going to get his first one.
Oh, nice. Who's your game ball?
I'm going to go Sherm.
All right. Well done. Well done. Let's see. Will.
Yes, sir.
What you got for us?
Well, I couldn't help but notice that when you were giving out the scores of the last several games, it seemed like they gave up 24 points every third game. So since it is the third game, I'm going to go Seahawks 24, Panthers 13. And I think we're going to make a concerted effort to keep the ball away from the one guy on the Panther squad, the one guy remaining, anyway, who can beat us, and that's Cam Newton. And I think that's going to translate into a time of possession of 40 minutes for Seattle with lots of runs, lots of short passes. Wow. I think we're going to try to just keep the ball as much as we possibly can. And I'll give my game ball to Marshawn Lynch because, like Mark, I think he's going to have a very good game.
All right. Matthew.
I got a feeling. This is a bad one.
Oh, no.
Now, I did originally say, as I say, this is one of the games we're going to lose, and I'm going to stay with that, I'm afraid. I've got Seahawks 20. I've got Panthers 24. I've got the Panthers will not score in the second half of the game, though, so we are going to go heavy. The first opening is going to be bad for us. My game ball is going to go to Cooper Helfrich, though, still, because he's just... but, yeah, I'm afraid I have that Thanksgiving feeling, let's say.
Oh, jeez.
Well, it's funny. He switched his vote last time, yes. And we lost, so...
Yeah, it's true. Well,
I'm not switching this time.
It's funny because I'm giving the same score for the good guys, 24-20 Seattle.
Okay.
And I'm going to say over 200 yards rushing as a team. They're just going to run the ball down their throats. Everybody's going to be involved. Lynch and Michael and Russell and everybody. And I'm going to give the game ball to our quarterback because I know it's an easy out, but I'm going to go with Russell Wilson, and I think that's a good game ball. Yeah. Okay, well, Mark, we are so glad that you were here with us this evening.
That was fun.
It's always fun having you, and unfortunately, like all fun, things have to come to an end. So it looks like it's time to bring another wonderful and amazing 12th Man Fan Jam show to a sad close. We are so glad you all decided to waste time with us. It was, as usual, a show that raised the bar here at Seahawk Positivity YouTube channel, and we certainly hope you laughed a little, you cried a bit, and maybe, just maybe, you learned a little something along the way. And what did we learn this evening? Well, we did learn a couple things. For example, we learned that Antonio Brown thinks the NFL refs are fascinating, because he called them the effing refs.
Fabulous.
Yes. And we learned that DeMarco Murray likes iMac. And we also learned that for some reason, Mark Tye Turner likes Matlock, or at least the theme of. So,
On behalf of Dustin, Statsman Mark, our news hound Shadowhawk Will, and my partner in crime Matt, and our very special guest Mark Tye Turner, this is your self-appointed Reverend Moses of the St. Paul Island Church of Seahawk Positivity, saying enjoy the game Sunday, and go Hawks.
Go
Hawks.
Go Hawks.
Hawks.